So it's my privilege to introduce to you our speaker this morning. Dr. Waller is an addiction, pain, and emergency medicine specialist and a senior medical director for education and policy at Camden Coalition of Healthcare Providers. Before joining CCHP, he worked for Spectrum Health System in Grand Rapids, which is a fully integrated health system with 11 hospitals and over 1,000 employed physicians. He was the medical director of Spectrum Health Medical Group Center for Integrative Medicine, the medical staff chief of pain medicine to the Spectrum Health Hospital System, the president of the Michigan Society of Addiction Medicine, as well as substance use director, medical director at Lakeshore Regional Partners. Dr. Waller earned a Master's of Science in Neuromolecular Biology at Southwest Texas State University, and he earned his medical degree at the University of Texas Medical School in San Antonio. Dr. Waller completed his emergency medicine residency at Thomas Jefferson University in Philadelphia and is board certified in addiction medicine. Dr. Waller's special interests include creating a comprehensive workforce development suite for the care of complex, high-cost patients, understanding the biopsychosocial and financial impact of high-cost, complex patients, as well as the unique interaction of pain and addiction. It was my request in planning this meeting that we could do a little vignette of his presentation just for medical staff, because working with so many of you, I recognize that the discussions that you have with your peers are different than discussions with other people in the room. So with that, please, Dr. Waller.
Great, thank you. All right, morning. So my morning started by my telephone not charging and waking up with absolutely no idea where I was going. I was in Indiana and I gave an 8-hour presentation yesterday. And I realized that I had to use an actual map, which is a little weird, right? You know, it's a piece of paper. These things you look at, they're lines that are apparently where roads go. So those are that was the good start to the morning coming from there. So I lived in Michigan for 10 years. I now have moved to New Jersey, which was a little bit of a punchline where I grew up in Texas. They'd be like, what are you from, Jersey? And now I have to kind of say yes, which is always a bummer. But my new role is really about developing the education and the policy around building systems of care and how to do these things right. And so to disclose, I have no pharma, no device income, never have. And I'm clean on the Sunshine Law stuff, no lunches, no pens, no anything. And my entire goal is to really develop the evidence-based strategies for approaches to patients with pain and addiction, and especially those with both. Now, we know that this coalesces onto a large number of people, and it's not just about one subset of the population. It's not that one person that you think about. Every one of you have a little bit of a different person in mind when you talk about the complicated pain patient or a patient with addiction. And in the clinic that I worked in for Spectrum, we developed for our high-cost complex patients. This was a clinic that only saw patients that were in the ER 10 or more times per year, 2 out of the last 3 years, pregnant on a controlled substance, or admitted 3 or more times per year. So we only saw really the top 5% costliest patients and those with really the most complicated issues. And we did it in an interdisciplinary way, which means that it was myself, a social worker, a medical assistant, a case manager, and then we had 3 teams, and the other 2 teams were staffed with mid-level providers and a master's level therapist and an MA. And what I learned in that was how little we had really been taught about dealing with the issues of addiction and pain in a very pragmatic way. I mean, we can talk about the ascending spinothalamic, spinomesencephalic tract and this stuff, and that actually like it given my background in neuroscience, but at the same time, that's going to put you to sleep. So what I want to do today is actually give you your hour and a half worth of time of practical knowledge that you can take and you can do something with tomorrow. So this is not going to be me preaching to you about, you know, this is how you should do it, because I don't work in your setting, I don't see your patients, and I don't live in your community. So you know those things better than I do. And so my job is to apply best practices to the things that you have to do on a regular basis. So I need to start with, I kind of despise PowerPoint, so I have three or four if we need to pull some up to show you some bullet points and these things you'll have access to after the fact. But most of what I would talk about from addiction will be in the guideline document that they gave you, and from a pain standpoint, we're actually writing a companion guideline that'll go for chronic pain treatment that also consolidates the CDC guidelines and a number of other guidelines out there. But more importantly, it's how to have that conversation with the patient, which is really the hardest part, because writing a prescription and knowing a dose is actually pretty easy. Understanding the neuroscience is actually easy compared to having the conversation with someone that you've had on opioids for 15 years, or you inherited from someone who retired, and or someone on the floor of a hospital who is screaming and yelling because you're not taking care of their pain, and the only thing that will fix my pain is another milligram of Dilaudid. So the goal is to try to figure out not only what is the science behind how you approach this, and what does the literature tell us, but also what is the very real human interaction that you have with those patients in order to be successful in getting them to, you know, kind of buy in to reality. So I'll start with kind of understanding who's in the room, and how many people here primarily work in a hospital? Couple, how many primarily work in the outpatient? How many people write for opioids? How many people write for benzodiazepines? How many people write for buprenorphine? Okay. Which is interesting, right? Because it's probably the safest opioid out there yet. It feels more comfortable as a physician a lot of times to write for an oxycodone prescription than it does for a buprenorphine prescription. So we'll get a little bit to why that is and why it shouldn't be, and then kind of what are the barriers to feeling comfortable using some of these medications for good rather than so-called evil. So we'll walk through that a little bit. We have a list of topics that we can talk about, and so one of the things is how many people, and I'll basically just talk about what you want to talk about, and feel free to ask questions as we go, because I would rather take a specific question about a specific thing and deep dive into the answer for that rather than talk about 60,000 foot generalities, which is really tough to take home sometimes. So feel free to ask a question about a specific patient, a specific scenario, any of those things as we go along. How many people want to hear about post-operative pain treatment? How many people want to hear about chronic pain treatment of kind of all kinds? Great. How many people want to hear about the difference between pain and addiction? How to determine if somebody has addiction rather than just they're angry? All right. How to determine whether or not somebody who has addiction actually you have the capability to treat or you need to refer them. How to not be angry when you leave your office on a regular basis. How to not hate the job you've chosen. Right, so these are all realities that I dealt with, because when I started this, I chose emergency medicine in medical school basically because I couldn't choose. I mean, I really did like everything I rotated through. Even my VA psych rotation was super fun for me. So I couldn't really choose what I wanted to do. And so in not choosing, I didn't choose. I chose the one that let you touch really everything. And I trained in Philadelphia in an inner city and was really good at the knife and gun club stuff when I left there. And I'd done more emergent thoracotomies than the chief of trauma at Butterworth Hospital when I arrived as a brand new ER doc with my first job out of residency from Philly. And so I was ready, I thought, to work at a trauma center. But a trauma center in Grand Rapids is not a trauma center in Philadelphia. A trauma center in Grand Rapids, which was at the time the 10th busiest ER in the country, and we saw 135,000 patients per year in the same emergency department, and I didn't do one thoracotomy. There was not even a hint of a thought of a possibility of doing something like that. But what I did see every single day were patients who came in complaining of chronic pain that was poorly treated and what ultimately was more suffering than pain, and trying to figure out the difference between those two. And then I realized pretty quickly that I had had very little to no training in that area. I had had one lecture in pain, and that was about how much Dilaudid I could give someone before they would stop breathing, which is really dependent on the cutoff between, if you're 75, it's not much. If you're a little less than 75, who knows? And they'll tell you, right? They'll tell you until they can't tell you. And then at that point, you bag them and give them a little Narcan and then send them back to the floor. But the reality is, that was about the amount of training that we got on pain evaluation and treatment within medical school. And that's pretty common throughout everyone whether you're a PA, an NP, or a physician. And on addiction, we got the lecture from a physician in recovery who was an anesthesiologist who got busted using fentanyl. And it was more a lecture about how not to get caught using fentanyl than it was a lecture about what addiction is and does and not. So that made me realize that about 4 months into my training that I hated my job, which is a real bummer, right? You know, you go through residency, your medical school residency and all of this, and 4 months in, you're like, I've chosen the wrong thing. And so I started working on what did I hate about my job, and it was really the subset of patients. It was the subset of patients who would come in and did not, in my mind, appear sick. They were angry, they were frustrated, they would yell at me, they would be in the hallway, they would, you know, create all kinds of havoc. And there was only one way that you could treat them, and it was through an IV push narcotic or an IV push benzodiazepine or a combination of the two. And then I saw my elder statesmen, physicians, just giving it to them without second questions and, you know, trying to learn what is the right way to handle this patient population. Because most of the time as physicians, we were trained that there were two things you would do. One, you would say no. Two, you would then capitulate because everybody was angry at you that they were screaming at them and not you, because we would go into a different room to chart slash hide. And then when we went over there, we would then call the social worker, which, you know, are these magic people that make the hall bed people go away in the emergency department. I'm not sure still how they do it, but all of a sudden they would be gone. And that's the way that it kind of went, right? You know, you would do that until you got the patient who had real chest pain in your mind, or the patient who had, an acute abdomen, or, you know, whatever it was that you were searching for as the, quote, sick person that you needed to take care of. But as we started to do this over time, what I found is that the sickest people in my emergency department were actually those that I had blown off, because they have a chronic debilitating illness that not only impacts themselves, but impacts healthcare dollars, impacts their entire family, and now, as we're seeing, severely impacts communities. And this is a real problem when 20% of moms showing up to random OB clinics are positive for opioids, you know, when they tested those. I just heard that literally driving on the way up here from Indiana, the study that they just did, that 20% of the random selection showed up for positive for opioids. So this is a problem, and 25% of the country has some form of an addiction, whether it's behavioral or chemical, and that means that we have 37 or so million people. Now, it used to be we would take a disease, any entity, and say, well, this proportion of the population has it. We would then eliminate the pediatric population and say only the portion of the adult population. But we don't do that with this disease. This is an early onset disease. This disease starts now at around 12. And so what we're finding is that this is as much of a pediatric and adolescent problem as it is an adult problem. And the prevention, again, starts in the pediatric area, but starts even before that. It starts before, you know, it starts at conception, because some of the patients that I treated were moms on controlled substances, and they would be pregnant. And so treating that mom at that time actually then sets that newborn up to do well after that. So this is a matter of, we have to be identifying whomever comes in, and that, how many people in your primary practice screen everybody for substance use disorder? Right, 25% of the population has a substance use disorder, yet we don't screen for it. One of the top three causes for early mortality, substance use disorder. If you actually rope in smoking, it's pretty much all the reason for early mortality. Because if you look at the highest healthcare dollar issues, what is it? It's the three top things, right? Smoking, obesity, alcohol. Obesity, we find that in a subset of a population, actually supermorbid obesity leading to early heart disease and hypercholesterolemia and those things, those patients have the same reaction to glucose as some people have to heroin, where they have a significant bump in the dopamine in the central axis and the reward system, and so they end up with the same behaviors that we would see in a patient seeking heroin. They seek glucose. So in the end, the top three causes of early death, the top three causes of cost in our healthcare system are addiction related, yet we don't screen. So when I've asked over 300 docs why we don't screen, the answer is, well, what do I do when I find it? It's really complicated to take care of these patients. They'll quietly tell me they don't want to have to take care of these patients, because ultimately they disrupt the entire clinic when they come in to be seen. And these are all the things that we continue to hear. Now, Now that this has crossed over from a low socioeconomic disease into a ubiquitously obtainable disease, and we find that high school kids at the nicest high schools are dying of overdose. We find that any one of our neighbors has enough drugs in their cabinet to kill many children or adults, in that matter, based on how we prescribe medications and how they sit around in people's medicine cabinets. This is something that is now becoming a total population issue that we have to deal with. So in dealing with that, the first thing that we have to really talk about is how do you screen for this disease? Because if you can't screen for it, everything else I'm going to tell you is actually useless. So we screen for chronic pain. How? How do you feel today? Do you have pain? On a scale of 1 to 10, how is your pain today? You know, are you smiling? Are you not smiling? Are you grimacing? Which one of those completely useless scales am I going to choose to determine chronic pain? Because those were actually only validated in acute pain, yet we still use those in chronic pain assessment. Chronification of pain is a whole different mechanism than the acute pain axis and how that works within the body. So we screen for pain, but we don't. Because when you screen for chronic pain, you actually have to screen for function. You shouldn't screen for what their perception of the pain is. You screen for how they function with that perception of pain, because that's what chronic pain does. But yet for addiction, we don't, which is the largest fundamental risk for the riding of the opioid pain medication that we have. And then benzodiazepines are right on their heel. And this is all in a mismatch of use of marijuana that kind of bleeds in and out of this population pretty consistently. And it's now becoming more the rule than the exception in this population to find that if you do it. How many people use toxicology studies in their office on a regular basis? Is that for patients that you feel are misutilizing things? Or is it randomly for everybody? Like, you literally roll the dice and you say, today we're going to do this person who's on a controlled substance. How do you choose those random urine drug screens? Is it random or is it behavior related? Yeah.
On the other hand, if you've screwed up the last two, chances are you're going to get one. If you screw that one up, you're done.
And so one of the things that we found is that when we look at the way that those data are collected inside of an office, they become intrinsically biased unless you set up a rule. So without the rule, then a certain subset of patients who sound, look, and feel a certain way always get it, whether we believe it or not. And this has been done in hundreds of offices and hospitals. And to show the point, when we started looking at which newly delivering mothers get tested for drugs in their urine in a hospital setting, and this has been done in a number of hospitals, 93% of those were African American in a population that had exactly 13% African American. So that's just racist. And so we have to realize, and nobody intended that to be the case, but that's exactly what happened. And so what we have to look at is you set up a rule, and the rule is applied to every single person. And I don't care if it's grandma, super nice, awesome, or if it's the angry, 27-year-old with failed back. It doesn't matter. That takes away also any argument. So when you set up your urine toxicological screening within an office, if you just set up the rule in that every 90 days, everybody's going to get tested. In our clinic, everybody peed when they hit the door every visit. If you're on a controlled substance, you pee. And we don't necessarily test it because we didn't fire anybody. So if we found something abnormal, we would never let a patient go. And so they knew that even if we found it, that we were going to have a conversation. We may change the trajectory of what we're doing for them from a medical treatment standpoint. But at the same time, the consequences match the finding. And it wasn't an angry reply to somehow a personal rebuke on you of, well, this person isn't doing it because they're being, I can't believe that they took another drug. I mean, that's kind of like saying, I can't believe that my diabetic ate a Krispy Kreme and taking that personally. We don't do that. We're just like, it's probably not a good idea because your blood sugar is going to be 700. And we give them more more teaching. We change their scale. We do whatever it is. We tell them what the best thing to do is. But if you have the disease of addiction, which really removes your capability to make solid, appropriate, logic-based decisions to use or abuse a substance, and yet we hold them to a standard of perfection in their disease that we don't in anybody else's disease. So So if a congestive heart failure patient has a bump in their BNP, we're not like, we don't fire them from the office. We help to identify what the problem is, and then we maximize that treatment. Yet if a patient comes in with a positive urine drug screen, and you're writing them for a controlled substance, in many cases, they just get fired. And that's, I would say, completely unethical at every level. And I think that we should start seeing it that way, because firing a patient for having a disease that we have not gained the knowledge to treat, boy, that starts to get into a very slippery slope. Yeah?
And yet the government's holding our feet to the fire.
It's not really true. So we'll talk about the mandated pain is the fifth vital sign thing. So we all know that at the end of the 1990s, that pain is the fifth vital sign is made no sense, right? Because what was the competing vital sign that was out there for the fifth vital sign? Oxygen saturation. Something we could actually measure and has to do with, are you getting oxygen? Like, it has a mortality rate connection. But we chose pain, and we chose that because the American Pain Society and a number of other national societies were pushing, as well as Purdue Pharma, pushed to the order of almost $50 million worth of money to try to get that put into place. That was successful, and then magically they had a cure for pain, OxyContin, right behind it. So when that happened, what they said is we need to make sure that patients' pain is being addressed. Now, we actually misinterpreted that, all of us. I mean, this is not a one or two people. This is all of us misinterpreted that as saying that I have to use an opioid, mainly because we got no treatment, no training in other forms of pain. Because just because a patient wants it, there's a reason that these substances are controlled substances. They're controlled by the pen in our hand or by the click on our mouse, and they are controlled. You have to have a special DEA license to write for these. They need to be evaluated in the right person and then prescribed in such a way that we can do it. They're controlled because they have a known risk. They have a known risk of accidental overdose. They have a known risk of addiction quality, which we underestimated in the late 90s, early 2000s, and now the reality has set in of the addictive qualities of these. In the late 80s, this was thought about as a real problem when the pendulum was like, look, this, we just cancer pain, and you broke your femur. That's what you get. That's who gets opioids. And then we had people not doing anything for other people with chronic pain, and we thought that withholding opioids was the reason that they weren't getting good pain treatment. Well, what it was is that we weren't actually making the patient know that they have to own and work for pain relief. And this is an American cultural quality that we have to actually start to deal with in the confines of medicine, because you're not actually held to task from a financial standpoint if you have addressed the pain and you documented that you addressed it. You identified it, you addressed it, and even if the patient's not satisfied with it, you're not held accountable for that. So people use that all the time. So I dug into that, and there is no financial accountability connected to that. And they're actually, and if you look actually at the Joint Commission re-explanation of the addressing of pain and the utilization, I was on the committee that rewrote that. And opioids are listed as, opioids are only the last resort, period. We put yoga and mindfulness and like hopscotch and everything else in front of it. So to choose opioids is our choice. That is our choice as physicians, to choose that is the way in which we are going to address their pain. So we're not really held to the fire when you deep dive into that. And anybody who's in middle management or even upper management in a hospital who tells you that that's the case, we as physicians, we took an oath. They did not take the MBA oath, right? There was no oath at the end of their MBA, no matter where it was, that says you have to make sure that you do no harm. Primum non nocere, right? You know, we all did this. And so we're in a point where we have to now actually realign the ethical promise that we made to be given the privilege that we have to be physicians with, you know, some other people who have other things. You know, no margin, no mission, no this or that. We got to push through patients. I don't care. So if we do that as a group and say, my job is to take care of patients and to do a really good job and to be safe. Collectively, they really can't argue with that, since it is the income that we produce through seeing patients in fee-for-service or ACOs or this or that actually pays their salary. That's what allows them to have a job, is us seeing patients. The better job we do for patients, the more margin you actually make, and that's been shown over and over. And there's actually two papers now that show patient complaints are not related to whether or not you write an opioid. They are related very specifically to how you address their pain. So when it comes down to it, if a patient comes in and they complain, that's a difficult patient. It's like if you are an intensivist and you have a patient who is septic and you have multi-organ failure and you're trying to look at adult ECMO on this, that's a complicated patient. You're having to think through a lot of stuff and you're having to watch a lot of numbers and a lot of time. So in the outpatient setting, the equivalent to that patient who is septic is the patient who has poorly treated chronic pain, suffering in their life from all sides, early life trauma, and you know the gray zone into addiction. I mean, that is the patient who is the ICU patient in an outpatient setting. They take time, they take effort, they take time and effort away from other people, you know, who are, quote, more motivated to get better. And so many times we're not sure how to actually fit them into a practical workflow. So it comes down to the fact that I don't have time to deal with this. And that's a very real probability until you change the way in which you set up your day to deal with those patients. And so for patients that have addiction, so when I've gone in and I've helped clinics set up how I'm gonna take care of addiction patients in a primary care setting, because what you don't do is you don't just weave them in your normal day, because that just wrecks your whole day, because they come in and they do have crisis more often than other people. They do have escalated and movements of behavior, which I'll talk about in a sec about why that is. But that should be expected. And so behavior in this disease, the disease of addiction and chronic pain, is a symptom of that disease. It shouldn't be a frustration. And once you understand it as a symptom of a chronic illness, it's much easier to deal with this without the emotional response that we have with it. So now this is not something that I've done at all from the beginning. This has been a matriculation for sure. And so when I first started in the emergency department, I was the guy who didn't give opioids. I mean, I was like, I'm not doing this. But the way in which I did it got me the most complained about ER doc, not only at Spectrum Health Emergency Medicine Group, which had 75 doctors, but there were 40 other hospital systems in this same pool of ER docs that they were doing patient, you know, relations studies on. I was number one in 40 hospitals around the country on this thing. And I thought it was because I was the only one saying no. Right? So I took it not as I did it wrong or that. I'm just the only one saying no. And then when they come back 30 minutes later to triage to be seen again for the same thing, and they want to see so-and-so doctor, and that doctor just gives it to them, then the patient splits. It makes them point at me as the bad guy, and so therefore that's why I get complained about. I was okay with that. We can do fire me? Fine. I can go get another job. I'm an ER doctor. You know, I can go work anywhere. I mean, that's like the ultimate, like it's like being a plumber. You can just kind of go be a plumber. I mean, it's, you know, it was an ER doc. So you, at the end, I didn't really care about that. But then all of a sudden, I had three patients in a row over a period of about a week that took the time to explain to me, and I actually got stuck in the room with them, you know, in that way, because there was other stuff going on. The nurse was, you know, busy and all this stuff. So I'm like, I have to discharge them, and here's your discharge papers. And then all of a sudden, I found that, you know, I'm not angry at you because you're not giving me opioids, is what one of them said. She had actually lost both of her legs from peripheral, you know, starting neuropathy, diabetes management issues. And she had to go to dialysis all the time, and she was always coming in for headaches, and she was only get better with opioids. And what it looked like, she was basically on an every three-day opioid withdrawal cycle, and that's what was causing her headaches. And because she couldn't get everybody would write her for the ubiquitous, like 10 to 20. 20 was our set point in our EMR. So when you discharge somebody with Norco, everybody got 20. And it wasn't because you thought, how many per hour, what do they have? It was because that was the set point in the computer. So they got 20. 20 would last her for 3 days. And so every 3 days, she would then have opioid withdrawal and get a headache. Well, after I talked to her a little, or after she talked to me, because I wasn't in the mood actually to talk to her, because I'm an ER doctor. I got to see sick people. I don't need to see. Now, I'm obviously telling this to a person who's got renal failure, missing her legs from her medical problems, and, you know, has no other transportation. And then she goes, you know, well, I'm not mad at you because you're not giving me opiates. I'm mad at you because you're mean. I'm not mean. Yeah, you're mean. What? Really? I mean, nobody had ever really said that from a patient's standpoint. You know, they called me names, but that name calling just reinforced that they had a problem and not me, right? You know, they'd be like, you're blah, 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 and all this stuff. And but that made me start to think that maybe I'm not doing a good job of explaining it, and maybe I don't have an explanation for it. And then I started seeing these patients that are in the ER 10 or more times per year on Wednesday mornings in the urgent care area and asking them to come in. And so I randomly picked 30 of them to see that I'd run on this list. Every one of them showed up. These are people who've been fired from offices all the time and missed appointments and didn't do that. Every single one of them showed up for multiple appointments in the morning over a six-month period of time, including the one with no legs, renal failure, and that. And she called me crying because she was going to be late for an appointment because she missed her bus when there was a foot of snow on the ground. And so this made me realize that it wasn't necessarily a them problem. It was a combination of an us-them misconnection. Because when I started talking to her about why I didn't want to write her for opioids and why I didn't think it was very good and I thought that it was making it hard and in all these other pathways, she goes, fine, I'll be happy to do these other things. Nobody's ever actually offered me other things. And so sitting down and having the conversation with these patients of, look, and we actually have data now to back it up. When I was doing this, we didn't have the CDC guidelines. You know, we didn't have the new swinging of the pendulum that puts us in a point where we have large amounts of data that says that utilization of opioids for chronic pain is a horrible idea because those patients' function decline faster than if you don't use them for the same disease. Their pain actually gets worse over time, and that opioids postoperatively should be used for 3 to 7 days at the most, no matter what the surgery. And then at that point, if you have chronic back pain or you have that, then what are the two things that give you the best long-term pain and function outcome for chronic low back pain? Cochrane database level stuff, multi-meta-analyses, you know, prospective randomized controlled trials over years that have always shown these two to be the same. What was that? No? Yoga and mindfulness. Those are the two things that have been shown to actually very consistently decrease chronic pain, increase function. Every time. More studies on this than all the opioid studies put together. You know, people will bring up, you know, muscle relaxers or non-steroidal anti-inflammatories or celecoxib or, you know, some of the COX-2. No. This is work. This is a requirement that you actually start to do things for yourself, and that's where we start to get into the problem. Because they walk in, and we walk in, we have 15 minutes, they want more than 15 minutes, or less sometimes, they just want what they want. They've gone to Dr. Google, and Dr. Google says that this dose of Oxy works really well. Or they've gone to Dr. Neighbor, and their Dr. Neighbor says, when I got this dose of Percocet, I felt totally better. And so they are telling us what they need, and we're taking offense to that. And we shouldn't take offense to that. We should just make sure and explain to them why that doesn't specifically fit them. Because you have to remember, patients are medical experts about themselves. And we are medical experts about the stuff we can apply to themselves. And so we have to meld those two together because many times we talk down to them without even thinking about it. Like, look, you know I don't live in your shoes, but this is what you're going to do. But that next step is, I don't live in your shoes. I don't wake up in your house. I don't do, you know, any of the things that you do. You know your body better than I do. But my entire life training has been around how to take medicine and therapies and that and then apply it to you once you tell me what's going on. So, yes, you are the expert about your body. You know what your body does. But I have to look not at a moment in time, but your lifetime. I have to make a decision not for what's going to make you feel better today, but what's going to work in a week, in a month, in a year, and in 5 years, and in 10 years. And the hardest part of my job is to know that you want to have it fixed right now, that you want it now. And I have to fight against that, wanting to give you something to make you feel better in the short run that's going to hurt you in the long run. And I have that conversation with them all the time. Look, it is a much easier conversation for me to have with you to just write you a prescription and let you go, right? That's just an easy conversation. There's none. It's like, thank you, I love you, you're my favorite doctor. It's much harder to sit down and have that conversation. So letting them know that it's harder to have that conversation is perfectly fine. I'm willing to have it. We're going to sit down and we're going to have it. I'm going to explain to you about what the CDC guidelines look like. And they're going to say, well, I'm not a guideline. I'm not a textbook. No, you are not. And even if you are the 1 in 10 million, which everybody thinks they are, if you're the 1 in 10 million, it still says this is the pathway that we should choose to start. And we should only end here in failure. So the concept of this approach is important to understand, because having that conversation with patients, it's easier now to not start somebody on opioids because we know. So the prevention side is easier within the walls of the office. I have pain, why won't you treat it? My grandma's on this med and she says it works. Because we now have data to show that that was the worst thing we could have possibly done. So I apologize for doing that to your grandmother. I apologize to patients all the time for what we collectively have done to them. Because when we look back at it, we did it. The reason that heroin is where it is not because of a bunch of miscreants. It's because of a bunch of people with MDs and DOs. We wrote those prescriptions. We got the pills on the street. They were then utilized by people who didn't even need them, because we wrote them for 30 or 45 tabs when they only needed 3 to 5 days. They got pulled from their, you know, medicine cabinets. They got used by these kids. They got all this stuff done. We should just own that. We should just own it and be fine with it. We did it. We used the best data that we had. We made a bad decision. We have new data. And when we look back at it retrospectively, we made a very bad decision, because the data for utilization of opioids is crap. There's not one publication in the history of opioids that has ever shown that utilization of opioids greater than 9 months yields any benefit. Not one. There is not one publication in the history of benzodiazepines that shows that long-term utilization of benzodiazepines for anxiety-related illness is helpful. So we have no excuse, to be honest. There is no science to back up that opinion. So the decisions that we make now, you either base it on science, data, and math, and forgiveness, or you just keep doing what you're doing, which we all know is absolutely not working. So then we get down to the brass tacks of, okay, fine. Let's say all the data is right this time, you know, right? Because we're back on the cycle, right? But now we have more cumulative data capabilities. We have more ability to randomize populations to get better data. We have more data to look at from international studies to match up with cohort data to look at different genetic populations. So we have a different level of data to look at this point than we did in the 80s, than we did in the 90s. And to look at that data, it's pretty hard to dismiss the fact that there is zero pieces of data that show us that opioids long-term are good. Right? We have, however, hundreds of pieces of data that show that other pathways of treatment are much better for pain that is either acute, chronic, or becoming chronic after that initial treatment phase. But then how do you take those people who have been on opioids for 10 years, right? You're in an area where you have hardworking farm people who go out and they work and they hurt and they wake up and they try to do their job. And every time they come in, they've been on the same dose of Norco for the last 10 years, and they can't work without it. And they come in and say, why would you take away my Norco? It's the only thing I can use to get up in the morning. So you should just know that if they've been on the same dose of Norco for the last 10 years, it's a placebo. They have built an internal tolerance to that what they feel when they stop it is withdrawal. Now, are there people that will take 10 in a month? You know, and that's the type of prescribing that a low-dose opioid can be really helpful for chronic pain that decreases function for somebody who's still functioning well, right? These are people who still go out and have to do, like, high-functioning physical stuff, and they can't sleep at night because they hurt so bad, and they're getting an ulcer from all the ibuprofen that they're taking. And, you know, you're not going to necessarily talk, you know, the farmer into doing yoga in the morning. I'm aware of this. It has a bit of a branding problem, right? You know, I grew up in Texas, so my dad's a Force Recon Marine, and so I try to have the conversation with him about his chronic pain and how yoga and mindfulness is there. And he suggested that we rebrand it to mindfulness to sniper training, sniper focus training, and that we rebrand, yoga to like ninja training, you know, balance training or something, because otherwise nobody's going to do it. And he's right. But when they do it, they do notice a lot of these positive things. But getting someone who's been on these meds for a long time and making that your focus, that shouldn't be the initial focus and the change in how you manipulate your patients. You just have to say, look, if you stop these medications, you've been on them for a long time, your body has built tolerance. If you stop these medications now, you're most likely going to have withdrawal, and that's going to feel like everything you're describing. I ache all over. My one area of pain hurts worse than it should. They start to produce even a little bit of allodynia or hyperalgesia, which is pain out of proportion to exam or pain for a non-painful stimuli. And you know, those people that you touch their back with your fingers and they're like, ah, that's hyperalgesia. They need to be off opioids yesterday. We are causing the problem with opioids in those patients because hyperalgesia to that extent does not occur, especially in patients with a completely normal MRI. Or the ubiquitous, you know, chronic degenerative changes, you know, so chronic degenerative disc disease. What portion of the population who's 23 years old who has random MRIs has chronic degenerative disc disease? 48%. 48% will be read as chronic degenerative disc disease with zero pain. It's not, MRIs are useless unless you're looking for a very specific ailment to identify something that has a surgical input or a specific pain interventional input that you can do. So when we start to look at these patients, the opioids have now caused more destruction than they have caused good. Same with benzodiazepines. If you're on benzos for more than about 6 months, if you stop them immediately, you have about 6 months of withdrawal, and that's like breakthrough anxiety and pretty horrible stuff, you know, for patients. And the data is relatively clear that utilization of benzos is for a month to 3 months at the most, and it's typically for catastrophic failure to regulate, and that could be because a family member died, a kid got hurt, you know, a divorce, or things where you got to still function in the world, and you give them that while you're onboarding an SSRI or therapy so that you can kind of meet in the middle, but you set a known end goal. But how many people have patients that have been on Xanax, Ativan, Valium, Clonopin for years? Useless, actually harmful. Those data are pretty clear as well, that we show that we actually take away the body's ability to cope, period, because it works so hard on the GABA system and the 5-HT2 system that you ultimately lose the capability to co-regulate. So it takes long periods of time to get that back. And so those patients who've been on this for 10 years, I always get them off. 100% of my patients, we got off of benzodiazepines. 100%. And it's actually not that hard if you do it right. You just say, oh, we can't use this drug. Oh my God, they're always gonna freak out, because if they're on Xanax, you know somebody on Xanax because it sits in the top of their purse or in their right pocket. If you say you're right-handed, you could reach in, you can grab the bottle of Xanax. They keep it right there. It is their coping mechanism because they've lost the capability to cope without utilizing that. Now, they don't realize that they're actually naturally coping, because when they take it and feel better immediately, it's still not the drug, because the drug still takes 17 to 22 minutes to actually start to have a clinical effect, and about 5 to 7 minutes later is when they're starting to feel better from that anxiety-provoking incident. So they're already self-regulating. So we immediately flip them from a short-acting benzodiazepine to a longer-acting benzo, so like a clonazepam, and then we wean it 10% per month. Take your time. I mean, they've been on it for a long time. 10% per month is like the magic number for most things in controlled substances, and if you go at that pace and in that consistency, what you're going to find is that ultimately you can get them off of these medications without a whole lot of internal static. You know, they're not going to freak out. You just set it up and you go, we're going to decrease it by 10% per month, and this is going to be tough, and we'll keep you close tabs. We'll get you set up to talk to somebody if you want, and help to move through that. For opioids, it's no different. When somebody's on, you know, high-dose, long-term opioids, and they're on the ubiquitous Norco 10s, 1 to 2, Q4 to 6, you know, but they never come in early. They're not like, I have a bunch of extra pills this month. What do you want to do with those? That never happens, right? That happens with their calcium channel blocker, their metformin, or their statin, but that never happens with the opioid. That somehow they lost a couple towards the end, or I needed a couple extra few for breakthrough pain and that. So in the end, what you do is you say, so you have pain all day, right? Yeah, all day. Wow. I mean, so you need something that covers it all day, and the medicine you have is not really helping you as much as you think, right? You know, as much as you want. Well, no. So we need a stronger med that lasts all day. Yes. Okay. And then you agree with them and you give them a stronger med that lasts all day, but it's something like an extended release hydromorphone. So they get Dilaudid, which is a very strong medication, but it's one pill a day and it's abuse deterrent and it's generic. And it takes a couple of pieces of paper the first time you get it approved, but after you get it approved, then they pay for it. And now pill counts are pretty easy, because they have to make a decision between take it or withdrawal. So if you're worried about diversion, this is also a great medication because in the end, they're not going to divert it if it's in their system. And you can give them, I go, wow, you probably need like 8 milligrams of Dilaudid, right? And they're like, yes. And they get like super happy in their visit and they love you as a doctor. But then when they come back and they say, it's not working like the other medications. The other medications made me feel better. And then what you say is, well, now we know what portion of your daily pain was suffering rather than just pain. Because what we were treating with that other medication was suffering and not pain. Because suffering is something that when you get this high peak and you raise dopamine and you create that artificial runner's high using, Norco, what we're treating is suffering. And that's what makes opioids so enticing for patients. Because you can have someone who has horrible early life trauma, a crappy home life, no job, frustrated everything, and chronic pain on top of it, which is made worse by all of those other things, and you give them an opioid, and it's like a magic medicine. Because it not only helps their pain, but it covers up their suffering. But it does it in the same way that alcohol does. And we don't anymore prescribe alcohol for suffering. And that's the way that I explain it to the patient. So what we need to do is really focus on the suffering. You don't get me. Actually, more than you know, because I'm standing over here, and I feel really sad that I haven't recognized this before. Take the hit on these things. It's so much easier just to be self-deprecating and move forward through this because they'll know that you care. They know that they'll show back up and they'll work through this. But having that conversation of putting them on a long-acting, opioid medication, and then once you put them on a longer-acting opioid, then you can start that slow wean off of that at that 10% per month. You can definitely go faster than that. I mean, I do opioids 20% per month generally, but go with the pace. I mean, if it's a patient who's been on these for a while and you're not worried about significant abuse or diversion, you're not in any rush, but you need to get them better in the right way that's going to last for an extended period of time. And there are good data that show that that's the easier way to do it, where you get them off of these medications over a period of time, and then you can actually start having conversations about what can they do to improve their pain. They're going to have to own a chunk of this. This is the cultural conundrum here. I want it now, and I want you to write me the script that's going to make it go away. You have to have a parental conversation with them. You don't get good at what you do without practicing. So you find what it is that they're really good at, what it is that they think that they're good at, and say, you've worked really hard at that, haven't you? Yeah. Well, that's probably why you're really good at it. Yeah. Well, that's exactly what we have to do for pain. You have to work at it. It is about exercise. It is about training. It is about training the nerves to not sense that as pain, but just to sense that as position. It is about training the brain not to automatically see pain as something that is sad, but pain is just something that is pain. And be able to go over, these pieces over and over and be consistent in message. And that means you have to train the people in your office to use the same message at their level. Because what they hear from the MA, what they hear from the front desk person, what they hear from you, what they hear from the nurse, is what anything that more closely resembles what they want is what they will latch onto. And I didn't recognize as an ER doc that I could wreck 6 months of hard work of an outpatient doc with two words. That's probably okay. Three if you count, as a word. But but when you look and they say, well, why can't it be an opioid? It's probably okay. That right there completely wrecks all that work that's done. And so coordinating with the hospital that your patients go to and making sure that everybody's on the same page is really important. You can put in a notice to the emergency department, my patients don't get opioids. Just say it, unless obviously they've had an acute injury. But outside of an acute injury, my patients don't get opioids. And the ER docs, they love that. It makes it easy for them. It's really helpful for me to be able to say, well, your doc doesn't want you to get it. Now, if we can train the ER docs to say that nicely, that would be better. Where they're like, dude, you're getting nothing. Check that out. That's not really super nice. It should be more like, your doctor seems to have recognized that this may not be a good pathway for you, so let's look at the other things that we can do. Well, I'm allergic to Toradol. I wasn't going to give you Toradol, but let's talk about that. Why don't we, So as we start to go through this, it is hard, it is long, and it is pretty arduous. And that's why I think a lot of the physicians and PAs and nurse practitioners that I've talked to, and especially in the rural areas, because in rural and remote areas, you don't have a referral pathway. Like, you don't have a place you can just send them to get the pain evaluation. You have to own all of this. So what I tell you is, tough shit. You chose to work in a rural area. You can go to an urban area where you can refer everything that breathes. to every other specialty that you want. They have a right big toe pain, but you like the autonomy and you like the capability to work in the place that you work. So suck it up. I know that's a hard message and sounds mean, and I'm sorry you can write your complaint to the same people who complained to me. But I'm just saying that there are positives and negatives for each place and type of medicine that we decide to practice in. And quite honestly, when you've chosen rural medicine, you can't just take the good. I get to scrub in on Fridays with surgery, and that's pretty fun. Or I get to sometimes work in the emergency department and do some of the fun stuff that I like to do. Or I get to see people from birth until, their whole family grows up and goes away. I mean, there are things that doesn't happen if you're a hospitalist. That doesn't happen if you work in a large multi-physician group that just sees kind of whoever kind of walk-in patients as they go. So you have to take the good with the bad, which means you also have to own a lot of these things that I won't ask other primary care doctors to own. I don't tell every primary care doctor they need to own the treatment of addiction. But here, you kind of have to, unless you decide collectively to recruit someone who can handle addiction and treat these patients. Now, I've had communities that I've gone out and they've levied property tax to train one of their local physicians and get them board certified in addiction medicine. I mean, they actually voted in a millage so that they could pay a physician to go do a fellowship in addiction and then come back and practice in their community rather than trying to import somebody who doesn't understand their community and who may not stay for a while and who may feel like an outsider rather than somebody who's done it. So there are ways to do it, but you have to treat it as a community problem. So any questions about pain? I'm going to move more into addiction. I realize it's an hour and a half, so it's not like we can do it. And I can give you, I'll send out plenty of stuff, and we're building a website that's Robert Wood Johnson funded, Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and AARP and a number of other foundations have funded a website called complex.care. So it's www.complex.care. And it'll have all of these things. It's all free, so I'm not trying to sell you anything. And it's through the nonprofit that I work for. And these are all going to be things that you can also show your patients, so it doesn't have to be always your word. So these can be a 30-second video on why we don't use opioids for chronic pain, but then also specific dosing requirements for things if you have to and how to do that. So those will be there because it's hard. You either deep dive on a specific topic in an hour and a half or you kind of give an overview and answer questions. And I kind of prefer to overview and answer questions if that's okay. Is that all right with you guys? Do you want me to deep dive on anything right now on pain?
Yeah. I had counseling. That didn't help me either. I mean,
So things only work as much as you put into it is the conversation you have. And so you have to decide what style of behavior modification you're going to use. And another term for that sometimes is parenting. And not to be condescending to the patient, but sometimes they need that help. There are times in which a parent does a good job of taking an adult kid and moving them through a stage in their life that they really need. And it's tough. And they have to tell them things that they may not want to hear. And that is our job. I mean, our job in the Marcus Welby sense is to actually help people through the toughest times in their life. And having chronic pain, having addiction, having suffering, and having all these combinations is tough. And so what they're going to say are all the things that they think are necessary for the easy path. They're going to say that. I mean, it's predictable. Because you could record it from one patient and play it for every one of your patients. So if it's predictable, and a pattern can be found, it's intervenable. So the intervening on this is a decision. Am I going to have that conversation with every patient? And the answer is either yes or no. Because I'll tell you, if you just pick and choose, it makes your job even harder because then patients will start to internally split your staff. You will feel conflicted because you will be treating someone different than another person. And so you just pick it. Everybody who has heart disease, who's over the age of 50, gets a baby aspirin. Right? That's just a checkbox. This has to be the same checkbox. And that checkbox is you have to practice. So we practice on, we do mock codes, right? We do these, we go to ACLS, we do retrainings, we always go. So the training you have to do with this is having that conversation. You have to practice. I have flubbed it up so many times over the years with patients, and you just practice it and practice it and practice it to the point in which it is what you do. What I do is I'm explaining to you, look, I know that when you went to therapy, it hurt. I'm happy that it hurt. You know why? Because if I went and I started doing bench press tomorrow, I'm going to wake up the next day, it's going to hurt like hell. I haven't done that in a decade. So that's a good pain. And what we need to start to figure out is how do we know the difference between good pain and bad pain? And let's start working through that. So I'm going to send you to a physical therapist, not for physical therapy, but for an evaluation. Because I want them to tell me what your limitations are, not you, because you're going to think you're limited, and I know you're not. It is all motivational interviewing. It is all Tony Robbins. I mean, it is absolutely, you can do it. Every little increment, you can say, wow, you only missed the last two appointments instead of the last three. That's awesome. I mean, you have to pick every piece of positive that you can find and move that, because they most likely aren't getting that at home. I mean, they most likely have never had that. And most of these patients have had a lot of abandonment, and so they're just assuming you're going to abandon them in this time of need. They are suffering. And we do have the capability to get them better, and it starts with the hard conversation. And it finishes with pretty easy stuff, you know, like stretching-based, you know, physical therapy. So you have to talk to the physical therapist that you're going to use. I would say you pick one or two. If you, you know, in this community, I don't know how many you have. What do you have, like 7, 8 total, you know, that work? And so you could bring them together and be like, all right, as a community, we need to do something right. We know that mindfulness and yoga help. So how do we improve, how do we add that into just physical therapy and make that a part of it? How do we then get stuff paid for? How do we do that? It takes work on our part, too, to get this structure built. But from a pain thing, I mean, it is frustrating because they're going to be like, I've been to therapy and it doesn't work. But therapy only works if you're out of the pre-contemplative stage. So you have pre-contemplation, contemplation, and then you start to plan a little bit, and then you get into action phase. And only if you're in the action phase is it going to do anything for you. I mean, cognitive behavioral therapy at its crux is taking someone's thought process and changing the behavior. I mean, we can train a Marine Corps sniper to be shot, finish a mission, and then worry about being shot. I mean, we can do that. We can train those human beings. When I trained in San Antonio, we would go to Brooke Army Medical Center where they trained all the Special Forces medics, and we would sit through these trainings that they would do for them. It was amazing. And I didn't know that it was ultimately just mindfulness, cognitive behavioral therapy, and that. But that's what it was, and they've been doing this for a long time. So it's done, and you can even frame it in that way. You know, this is not a time for you to quit. Your family needs you kind of thing. I mean, this is that. So if you're going to learn any one specific skill in behavioral health, it would be motivational interviewing. I would read books on it. I would watch YouTube videos on it. I would learn it. I would be a master at that. Because the minute that you understand that motivational interviewing actually is a science and that there are 7 frameworks of approach and there are retorts that are appropriate, that are, you know, pathways that if you go down, you'll drop into a hole. I mean, you will know that you've gone the wrong way. It is a science just like what we have. And practicing that, it actually, it works like a wizard. I feel like Yoda around my kids now with this stuff. It is completely, you know, go this way, you will not. And they're like, okay, I'm going to go this way. And they don't even know why. They were just like screaming a second ago, but I somehow using motivational interviewing, getting them to, you know, to do the right thing. And they're 4 and 6, and it's awesome. I mean, it's like you can do this for practical reasons, but at the same time, it is required for patients. So for the next 30 minutes, I want to focus on addiction. So we've talked about kind of screen, right? You got a screen. It's pretty easy. You don't have to do it as the physician. You can actually set it up to be screened by your medical assistant. You can put it in front. You can have the night of 4 questions done. Those are 4 basic questions the National Institute on Drug Addiction have put out in the last 6 months. If you used a prescription medication for something other than prescribed in the last 6 months, if you're a male, if you had more than 5 drinks at one time or more than 14 in a week, if you're a female, if you had more than 10 in a week or more than 3 at one time, have you utilized an illicit substance or have you smoked tobacco? I mean, those are the 4, you know, basic questions. And those are standardized questions. They're written in the way that they ask. And if they screen yes, then you go to the next level, which would be an audit or a DAST. I mean, these are all spelled out on the National Institute on Drug Addiction website. You can go to SAMHSA, Substance Abuse Mental Health Services Administration, and that's. But go to drugabuse.gov, and they have everything on there that you would need tool-wise. They actually have SBIRT spelled out exactly how you put it into your clinic. I mean, there's a booklet that you hand to your office manager and say, do this, and it has coding and all of that stuff. So you don't have to reinvent this. It's been done. So you screen for it and find it. So now let's understand it, because addiction is something that is not a decision. It's not what people wake up in the morning and they're like, awesome, I totally want to be a heroin addict because that sounds so glamorous and amazing. And it doesn't happen that way. It happens like any other chronic disease. You have a genetic predisposition, you have access to the thing that can cause the problem, you use the thing that can cause the problem, and it sets in motion the behavioral conundrums that go along with the chronic disease. The difference between this chronic disease and many others is congestive heart failure we define based on very specific New York heart parameters followed by a couple of lab tests. So it's very easy things for us to find. We define addiction based on behavior. So 9 of the 11 criteria that we use for addiction are based on behavior. So the question would come down is, why is this? Well, you're going to get the 9-minute, you know, addiction neuroscience lecture here, right? So we need 3 things to survive. We need food, we need water, we need dopamine. So dopamine is this chemical in the central axis of the brain, and it sits very specifically in the nucleus accumbens. And it's the chemical that's responsible for love, connection, the capability to be motivated to do that. So when you hear the word motivation, I want you to think dopamine. And when I say dopamine, you should think motivation, because that is the thing that causes the behavior. And the behavior of motivation is there. It's motivated to do better at work than you've done before. If somebody walks up and says, man, that was a great job you did, you're now motivated to do more and better because of that. And because of that dopamine, it pushes you. A mother-baby bond is there because of dopamine and oxytocin. And you have all of these things that relationship builds and all of these things that come along in life. That is responsible, you know, that happens only because of dopamine. The runner's high is a dopamine high, as well as opioids coming out of the periaqueductal gray, but well, that's another pathway. But if we talk about this, then we start to look at, you know, what is it that's normal? Like, what is the normal amount of happy motivation that a person needs? Is it that when a patient tells me that I give them 2 Norco and they can get everything done on a Saturday, when I take these meds, all of a sudden I can get everything done. I have the house clean, I have everything raked up, and I have that's not normal. That's not a normal Saturday for anyone, right? That's too much dopamine. So what we need to look at is, what is the normal amount of dopamine? And we've done that. When I say we, I mean really brilliant scientists that have PhDs and do this stuff for a living, not me. And like Elliot Gardner at NIDA, and they've done micropipetting in the nucleus accumbens and various other parts of the brain and in monkeys, and then they've then taken that and turned that into functional MRI studies so that they could equilibrate the amount of dopamine release versus what that looks like in what they call voxel morphology, which is the volume pixel relationship that sits on a functional MRI, which ultimately is density of activity that they can see on a functional MRI. And then they've correlated those and looked at human studies and have found, wow, the average daily amount of dopamine that kind of needs to be banging around in there for you to get out of bed and go to work is about 15 nanograms per deciliter, right? That's the concentration that gets you up, gets the cup of coffee, gets you to the next phase of the morning, gets you to this thing in the morning for like an hour and a half of listening to some dude drone on about, you know, how bad I am at what I do and why everything sucks and all this. That's 50 nanograms per deciliter, right? And then worst day ever, the day you're not going in. You're just not. You're going to call, you're going to fake vomit on the phone, and you're going to stay at your house, and you're going to stay in your pajamas, and you're going to do nothing. That is about 40 nanograms per deciliter. And then we have the best day of your life, right? The day you win the lottery, 2% body fat, you're sitting on a beach, like all of those things happen instantaneously right then. That's about 100 nanograms per deciliter. We look at your favorite food. It's about 94 nanograms per deciliter. Sex, 92. Bummer, right? So, you know, hoping those to be flipped, just not the case. I think they should still redo those studies. But as we look at this, what we do find is we have a range that we live in. And that range to live in, to be motivated to do things, to be constructive with other people, to have interpersonal relationships, to, you know, move forward in life is that 40 to 100. And nobody lives at 100 all day. You can't. It's pretty exhausting, right? You know, because think about when you have that 100, like if you've ever run a race and won, or you won a prize, or you got a promotion, or you did these things, or got into medical school, or whatever that happiness was, you felt like really tired the rest of the day. Like you had that and you're just like wiped. And so your body's not even built to be up there that long. So what happens if you take a methamphetamine? Well, that takes you to about 1,100 nanograms per deciliter. So a logarithmic scale of difference. So more than 10 times the amount that what our max is supposed to be. You look at heroin in the high 900s, alcohol in the 800s, marijuana in the 600s, all of these things way above where we should be releasing dopamine. Now, genetic predisposition may even allow that to go further. You know, so the sensitivity to these substances, you know, may pop it up, or priming things may make it worse. So if you're already primed with another addictive substance like nicotine or marijuana, that may prime you to have an even more profound reaction to an opioid, you know, or to any other, you know, many other things. So when we start to look at what is the cause and effect, the brain does not want to be here. It does not want to be at 1,100, so it likes homeostasis. It wants to only have its maximum be 100, so it will initially decrease the release of dopamine. If you continue to use and you use at a high level, it will then decrease the production of dopamine. And if you continue to use and you use at a high level, it will then suppress the size of the nerves. It will atrophy the neurons that go from the ventral tegmental area to the nucleus accumbens. And then if you continue to use, it will flip that cell biology switch called apoptosis, which is programmed cell death, and it will kill the neuron. And when you kill the neuron, it does not come back. It is a stroke. It's just like an ischemic stroke in the happy part of your brain. And there are a subset of patients who do not have any capability to make natural dopamine anymore. And these are people who live in a permanent state of what we call anhedonic depression, a flat affected depression. It's not a cry in the corner depression. It's not a super sad depression. It's not a depression with anxiety. It's just nothing. How are you today? Fine. You're on fire. Okay. Nothing. They can't come up with an emotion. Their kid's birthday, they'll smile because they know outwardly what's expected of them to do, but they got nothing going on inside. This is what this produces over time. And so even with the use of the drug, they may only get to the normal maximum over time, even with drug. But then after a while, all they're trying to do is maintain. They're just trying not to go into withdrawal. So let's say the best thing happens, right? We find this person, we screen for them, and we identify them, and then we get them into treatment. And and that treatment, for the most part, is what nowadays? What's the average treatment that a patient with addiction gets? Inpatient for a couple of weeks, you know, you get detox, and you get shoved into 12-step self-help, right? That's where we go. Right? All right? So what does that do? So let's say all those things happen. Well, now we have a person whose best day ever, their nucleus accumbens is producing 20 nanograms per deciliter because they don't even have the substance there that was maintaining it. And then on their worst day, it's like 8. These are the people who just don't even get out of bed. The 20 are the people that irritate us because they show up to our office in their pajamas. It's like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I'm like, why are you wearing those same pink fuzzy things with pictures of horses? I just can't see those anymore. I mean, but we'll make those comments. Like, they can't even dress, you know, put clothes on and come to the office. And we're blaming them as though somehow that's a choice. It's not a choice anymore. At this point, they don't literally have the dopamine capability to do the things that motivate you. Because remember, lack of dopamine means lack of motivation. So if I put them into a therapeutic situation with dopamine this low, dopamine in the nucleus accumbens is also required to onboard emotional memory. You cannot actually sustain and onboard long-term emotional memory without dopamine, appropriate amounts of dopamine in the nucleus accumbens. So what's another term for onboarding of new emotional memory? Therapy. So therapy becomes useless for these patients. What they hear is rah, 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 rah. Nothing. It's all taken over by this little voice in their head that is craving whatever their substance was. And what they're craving is not the substance, but dopamine. We'll talk about how we can boost dopamine, and we'll talk about the dopamine bump centrally with Wellbutrin and how it's not necessarily adequate and in the right axis. But we can look at that. But we have this group of patients who now, they've reset the mechanism. Therapy is not going to work on them because they don't have enough dopamine to onboard the change required. And so what will we do? We know what we do with a patient who has cry-in-the-corner depression, right? Like major depressive disorder with low serotonin. What do? We place serotonin. What do we do with a patient who has anxiety with depression? We can look at norepinephrine and serotonin, you know, changes. We can look at a bunch of different things that we want to change. And we don't think twice about that. So what if we had medication to actually bump the dopamine so that it takes over that craving that's there? Because the craving, the studies have also been done to look at craving to determine levels of craving as compared to standard craving. So craving in a starvation state, craving for water in a dehydrated state. And when they tested those, they would take people and have them not drink anything for 3 days, no fluids, period, no IV, no oral, and put them in a functional MRI and make them talk about water. And then they would sprinkle like water on their feet and touch their lips with water and make them talk about it. And then functionally MRI their brain for craving, because we know the areas of the brain for craving. And it's lateral bed nuclei, the amygdala, anterior cingulate gyrus, lateral prefrontal cortex. We know where these things are. And we did that for food. They didn't eat anything for 5 days. And at that 5 days, they functionally MRI'd them and made them talk about their favorite food. They would like waft the smell of food into the MRI and then like show their brain on that. And then they looked at people who had been off of their drug of choice for 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, 1 year, 18 months, and 2 years. And I'm only going to talk about, for that group, 30 days and 18 months, because there was no change in chemical craving for a year and a half for those patients. So if you look at the relative size of craving for somebody who had gone 3 days without water, it's about the size of a baseball, relatively. Now think about that, though. 3 days without water. If I walked across the desert for 3 days and you have a big glass of water in front of you and it's got like the condensation on the outside running down like a Sprite commercial, right? It's like perfect. And somebody steps in front of you and goes, no, that's my water. You'd be like, oh, okay, stab. And then you would move them out and then you would take the water and you would drink it. You would do that because that's a survival mode thing. You're like, I'm going to die if I don't get that. So therefore, you're going to die because I'm going to survive. And food, too. If you have somebody who's starving, they will steal from other people who are also starving. They will. There is no, like, pros-cons column made, right? You're not like, well, if I steal the food, I will feel better, but they may not be angry. You don't do that. You're just like, survival. So when we looked at food, that was about the size of a basketball. So we got a baseball for water. We got a basketball for that. And then when we started to look at craving, before 18 months, it was the relative size of a baseball field. So the intensity of craving for the drug of choice / dopamine, which is required to get out of bed in the morning, the body knows that without dopamine, food and water don't matter. So dopamine is the most important thing. Then the biggest thing, the biggest signal in their brain is this craving for their drug of choice. Nothing else really matters at that point. So the way that we can go back and chemically stabilize that patient is to raise dopamine. Now, we looked at things like Cinemed and things that are actual. Here's dopamine. Let's just see if that works. This is a primal protected part of the brain. It's not like the posterior elements of the brain that are less protected and actually newer to us from an evolutionary sense. These are protected primal things. So it takes such a high dose of actual dopamine, like L-DOPA, that you have too many side effects to take it. You have movement disorders and all of these things. If you look at Wellbutrin, which is a central part of what it does, is a central dopamine agonist, it actually requires dopamine production to be spit out more, so it doesn't actually act like dopamine. So the mechanism of action requires dopamine to be present to just do it, but in these patients, it's depleted. Now then what we have is this other piece that we can indirectly do it, and that's where buprenorphine and methadone come in. Because buprenorphine and methadone, if prescribed appropriately, raise dopamine to that 40 to 50 nanograms per deciliter without going up. Can you get high on these? Yeah, but for buprenorphine, it's hard. You have to have a boosting agent pretty much with buprenorphine. There's a small portion of patients who will use that as their drug of choice, but it's only like 1% of those patients who are the 5% of patients out there, so it's a small number. Methadone, if given, actually doesn't boost dopamine up that high unless, again, they boost. And they can boost with things like gabapentin, Lyrica, alcohol, benzos, marijuana, so any of those things. But once you stabilize dopamine, then we can actually start to onboard that emotional memory. We can start to do therapy that works. We can start to engage them in treatment because they will show up because they actually have enough intrinsic motivation to get out of bed in the morning and do these things. So utilizing buprenorphine for a patient with an opioid use disorder is so important in the armamentarium of approach to these patients. And quite honestly, it's an exquisitely good pain medication. And initially, the original data, there was some opinion out there that the brain got saturated, and so above a certain amount, it didn't do anything. But what we have found subsequently is that it's a partial agonist in the areas of the brain that matter, meaning it's a partial agonist in the respiratory center, so it's not going to shut off your breathing, which is great. You can take a bucket of it, and it's not going to do it. But as far as pain, you can go up to 10 milligrams per kilogram before you start to see a diminishing pain relief curve. So ultimately, you can use huge doses of this for pain relief. And we've had plenty of my pregnant patients on buprenorphine that we've done their entire pregnancy, delivery, and everything, post-delivery, even post-section, all just on buprenorphine without having to add any other medications. So it by itself is a good pain medication. And then looking at it from a sense of like the elder adult population, the Butrans patch, it's a patch that is buprenorphine, and it comes in four doses, and it lasts for 7 days. So it's a 7-day patch FDA approved for pain that you can put on for patients who have chronic pain if they feel like they need an opioid. And it's a partial agonist, so you don't have to worry as much about the constipation, as much about the side effects of the breathing issues and that. So it by itself is a good medication for that use. So what do you think about effectiveness, right? So if I take those people and I put them into a 12-step program by themselves, with no medication-assisted treatment, at 1 year, what's my outcome? What percentage of those people no longer meet for an opioid use disorder at 1 year? 8%. So 92% failure rate for that general population. I'm excluding doctors, pilots, and lawyers who have a different brain disease and addiction because of how long they waited to realize that disease, who actually do really well. Excluding those people, looking at who we actually see for a living, and what if I put them on buprenorphine and put them into just evidence-based cognitive behavioral therapy? 65% effective. Are we that effective for diabetes treatment? No, not even close. How about hypertension? No. But we treat those and we keep going at it and going at it. This is a disease that is not only identifiable, but treatable. And so utilization of buprenorphine, do you guys have a methadone clinic around here? An OTP? So what about the methadone outcomes? Those are 72 to 75%. Now I've never seen more people have such an emotional reaction to a drug than I do to people with methadone. So like you say methadone and you always have two or three people that are like, ugh. I mean, I never see a cardiologist have that reaction to like a calcium channel blocker, right? You know, not even to like Natricor, you know, they're not even like, oh, not, you know, but we have such this weird innate thing because somehow we think that the opioid treatment program is just basically replacing one addiction for another. It's not if it's done properly. And the reason that we get frustrated is because we do have examples of ones that have not done it properly, where they just give them a drug, they don't do therapy, they call it quits when they're 22, and they call it risk reduction. That's actually not okay. But we're looking to take OTPs and turn them into modified medical homes where basically they could treat all addiction and that would be a great referral base for you guys, as well as use all medications. So if you have an OTP in your area, a methadone clinic, helping them to figure out how they can maneuver and supporting them to maneuver into a modified medical home would be amazing, because at that point you'll have a place where you can send these patients after you've identified it and then work with them on helping them with their chronic medical diseases at the same time that they're able to treat their other more addictive disorders. But they're so maligned in a population so many times that they shut themselves off to be kind of quiet and to the side. But as a community, if you have one of those, you're already ahead of the curve, because you can then talk with them and work with your local coordinating body to say, how do we sit down as a community and use this to our great? Because you have a board-certified addiction doc that's in that place, and you have addiction-trained therapists in that place. They should be treating all of the addiction stuff, not just one drug, one version of substance use disorder, and only in one way. So you have to start looking at utilizing what you have and expanding the capabilities of that. Not an easy lift, but definitely something that can look into. So the concepts of this are mild to moderate opioid use disorder. These are things that really could be treated in primary care. I mean, they really could, mild to moderate. Severe really does need a higher level of care, just like many other diseases. If you have a patient with decompensated heart failure and COPD, they see the cardiologist. You know, they get tuned up and then they come back. And so it's the same way with addiction. If you have a patient that needs medication-assisted therapy, when they meet for the severe version of an opioid use disorder, they go to the specialist and they get tuned up. And then they should be able, however, to transfer back to you for continued writing of these medications that stabilize their dopamine axis. And that. And so to finish with, how long do you write for those? Well, it depends on which person they are. Are they somebody who just isn't squeezing out enough dopamine but is producing it? Is it somebody who's not producing enough dopamine? Have they atrophied their nerves or have they killed off the nerves? There's a portion of the population who's probably going to need this medication at some level forever, whether it's methadone or buprenorphine. However, there's a good chunk of the population that after that 18 months where things start to heal, and you say, from the time that you met for remission in your disease, it's now been 18 months and you've been doing really well, now maybe it's time to start to wean. And this is a person who weaning down takes a very long time on their pace and continue to do it. You're in no rush. We only have an emotional reason to rush the weaning of low-dose buprenorphine. You know, because patients want to be off of it. They don't want the label. We want them to be off of it for whatever reason, because we don't worry about that with other medications. But in the end, slow and steady gets that person off. And, I mean, that by itself is its own. I mean, I have a two-hour lecture just on weaning, so we're not going to do that in 7 minutes. But I think that those are the concepts of kind of the approach to pain and how you can change it, the understanding of addiction and that it is an actual treatable chronic disease, and especially when we can identify it early. And you have the guidelines that I wrote. So these are the state guidelines for Michigan, and that's what's being utilized in all the contracting around the state. We're updating those right now to have all the new medications that do the same thing and some of the other therapies. But I've written them specifically so you don't have to be a specialist to read them. So even if you just read the introduction in the buprenorphine and naltrexone chapters where it talks about how you can use Vivitrol in your office and things like that, I would recommend that to start. And then we'll have this website over the next few months up, the www.complex.care, which will have the 24 hours of education required for PAs and nurse practitioners to get their X license, which is now legal since CARA passed. They just haven't written the rules. So PAs and nurse practitioners will be able to write for buprenorphine very soon. And now we're just waiting on regs for that. It's already passed as a law. And then if you work in a certified practice setting, which means you have case management and the ability to get people to intensive therapy, you can have up to 275 patients per physician on buprenorphine now. And that's as of August 8th. So that's a now thing. So we have time for a few questions if you have them. I'm happy to answer them. I know you guys all have to go to work. Yes, ma'am.
For alcohol addiction, and maybe for other addictions as well, it would be great, you know, to have a Vivitrol injection in the clinic as part of health maintenance. But are you suggesting that although that will take away their response to alcohol, positive response to alcohol, they might still need some sort of dopamine as well? So, for example, for alcohol withdrawal to be successful, what we were traditionally told was to prophylax against DTs and de-equilibrium or anti-anxiety medication. But is it possible that we would be more successful with alcohol withdrawal and with most withdrawals if we were given some source of dopamine?
Yeah, so those the questions that center around using Vivitrol for alcohol use disorder, and does alcohol use disorder have the same type of dopamine deficiency as do the other addictions? That is the final common pathway, and the short answer is yes. We don't yet have the direct dopamine increase capability. Now, the other medications that we do have for alcohol use disorder, like Vivitrol, like Campersate, and things like Topamax and Gabapentin Baclofen that are showing actually some really good outcomes, those don't necessarily bump dopamine, but what they do is they significantly decrease craving. And they decrease craving to the point where you can give them a higher intensity therapy. Now, alcohol use disorder, while the final common pathway is still the nucleus accumbens and dopamine, affects other parts of the brain in a way that makes things like a 12-step program and directed cognitive behavioral therapy much more likely to raise natural dopamine. It takes a person using alcohol much longer and a much more extensive amount of use to actually kill the neurons as compared to opioids. Opioids seem to do it really fast. Methamphetamine does it really fast. I mean, these are things that seem to hit that area really hard and a very high potential. And so the good news is the vast majority of people who have an alcohol use disorder haven't killed those nerves and will be able to make natural dopamine again, but it takes other things. And we find some of the simplest things to raise dopamine in these patients ends up being things like exercise and treating the sleep disorder that's common for the 9 months after they stop drinking, so that they can have a regular sleep cycle and actually start to reproduce dopamine. So these are very common things that we've found end up being as good or better than some of the medications that we would use. But medication-assisted treatment for addiction really now has to be the rule. And it's almost, we're pretty much, in a big city, it's malpractice not to find somebody medication-assisted treatment for opioid use disorder. It's just malpractice, you know? And it's going to reach that for you guys, too. So, I mean, it's going to hit the point where 65% versus 8%, and the mortality rate that we're seeing from opioid use disorder, that's the highest mortality, you know, cause of mortality for injury-related death in the state and the country. I mean, we're at a point now where it's just going to be like, we have to suck it up and figure it out. I mean, because we have to figure out how we prescribe these medications, how we set up the systems to be able to do it. The good news is we actually know. We have good workflows for this. We have good things that we can set up in primary care. We have ways to bill for it now. The state, you're lucky you're in Michigan. Many states are behind Michigan in this, and that the state of Michigan will actually pay for an opioid use disorder visit to the office. So if you code opioid use disorder, they'll pay you a 992 code for that. And you just bill you know, through your normal mechanism to the state, and they'll pay you. So that's something that most other states don't have. And other states, you would have to be a part of the CMH to get paid, but that's not the case for opioid use disorder. And that will be expanding out to alcohol use disorder and other ones over time. But for now, you can get paid for seeing patients who have an opioid use disorder and coding that as your first diagnosis. And so working on that is something that you can definitely do.
Another question was recidivism with meth heads, like if you are seeing
a patient with a methamphetamine use disorder.
Methamphetamine use and gone through incarceration is now out. Is that person at a higher risk of recidivism if he or she is not given some source of dopamine on a daily basis?
So this is different for stimulants. So dopamine is a big issue with them, but we don't have a way right now. So there are some early studies that show that actually Vivitrol may, in the back door, increase dopamine through a blockade of opioids, causing this kind of reciprocal bump of dopamine centrally, because you're blocking their normal path of dopamine through some of the opioid system. So that so naltrexone may actually be doing that. There are two early studies. It's not FDA approved for that, and probably wouldn't get paid for that. You can try the oral version, 50 milligrams a day. It's dirt cheap, so it's not a big deal. But that one, citalopram, as a specific drug, given at just normal therapeutic doses, has a tendency to significantly decrease craving for that. It's not a class effect. It's a specific drug effect. And then Provigil or modafinil, which is a centrally acting stimulant, has mixed results. There were some studies that showed good promise and some that showed really no help. So that's going to be which of those subset analyses is going to be more helpful for those patients. But methamphetamine, the best outcomes for methamphetamine and cocaine is contingency management therapy. I mean, contingency management therapy is the best outcome for that. Well, as a therapy, that the simplest version of that is if you do something good, you get rewarded. If you do something bad, you get punished. And that reward can be as little as movie tickets or access to other places or things like that. And so these are setting up a solid contingency, standing up a solid contingency management program is one of the hardest therapies to set up, but it is the most effective for stimulants.
Could I interrupt? Yeah? Just one second.
Sure.
My apologies. I just wanted to take 15 seconds. My name is Victor Fitz. I'm the county prosecutor. I wanted to be here for your session, but they said, no, keep the prosecutor out. The doctors won't like that. So, but I wanted to at least come in and say hello. If you do have any questions about it, from my end of it, we want to work with you, doctors. We really appreciate all your involvement in this, and that's all the time I wanted to take.
Yeah. For you. Well, I've worked with Victor. He means what he says. He and I have worked together before, and I've done many things. So changing the way in which we adjudicate drug addiction is really important, and getting somebody into therapy with a long tail of probation rather than incarceration is one of the things that we're going to be able to do to help keep them kind of captured in a system of therapy and all of that. So, and they're working really hard to come up with these pathways and to really go after those criminals that are really the criminal pieces of this, the criminal elements who are bringing all of it in rather than punishing the person with the disease. So I definitely work with the prosecutor's office here. They've been a real friend to this whole process. So
as a nurse practitioner, I am kind of stuck sometimes when I get the patient who's on methadone that has been started by a physician who is no longer practicing.
Yep.
And then they come to see me, and I don't have a physician who agrees to write for methadone.
Yep.
And I call all the local clinics, and they don't fit criteria. They won't see them because they're not truly drug.
So the way that you do this is you have to actually give them the diagnosis of opioid use disorder, because it is actually against federal law to write methadone for opioid use disorder in an outpatient setting. The only people that can use methadone for maintenance are those with a specific federal opioid treatment license. So if you're writing methadone for, quote, pain, because that's what you code it for, so it gets paid for and it's dirt cheap, that is the most dangerous medication to put out on the street, period. So I would agree with your practitioner in not writing methadone. I don't write methadone. I had one patient on methadone that I wrote, and this was a person with sickle cell disease with necrotic hips and shoulders, and it actually, at medium to low dose, is a really good pain medicine, but you have to know exactly how to use it, and it should not be used on a regular basis because it's $7 a pill, and you have to write a mountain of pills per month on the street. So what you do is you just say, we're not going to write for methadone. And we're happy to flip you over to a longer-acting med, and you look at the same way that we talked on the other ones, that is, like a long-acting hydromorphone. You can even use morphine sulfate, the BID, you know, abuse deterrent versions, and then slowly wean them. Or you get use the DSM-5, and you diagnose them with opioid use disorder, and you send that diagnosis to the OTP, and when they say they don't meet criteria, you call bullshit. I mean, that's like a cardiologist saying they don't have CHF when they have a beta natriuretic peptide of 10,000. I mean, it just is what it is. The DSM-5 diagnosis is the lab draw. So you use the data to get them what they need. And if you get pushback from them, then you call your community mental health, which will work really hard to get your patient what they need, and they will intervene. And if they don't, then you email me, because I know the people in charge in the state still, and even though I don't live here anymore, I now live in Jersey, where we get things done in a certain way. So I'll make some calls. No, but in the end, this is something that's happening through the contracting pathway. They're going to be obligated to offer these services. So as they contract to get the money from the state, because if you look at your CMH, the CMH is the Medicaid health plan for mental health and addiction. That's what they are, right? So they have to pay for that. Now, it's very heterogeneous from county to county and how they pay for and what they pay for, but those things are, because we put guidelines down now, and they're contracted to be able to deliver these things, they are going to have to deliver evidence-based therapies at some level. You know, and if they're not, you got to push hard and get these people fired. I'm just kind of sick of these people.
Because our CMH is notorious for giving things back to us.
Yeah. No, it's not okay. Go loud. So the people you go loud with is the county commissioner. You go loud because there are people, they have bosses. Right? You go back to the state. You talk about the recovery, you know, the state's recovery-oriented systems of care. We have an opening at the top of that right now. Has that been filled yet? You know? Yeah. Okay, fair enough. So we need to find out. I'll ask the Lieutenant Governor this morning at our next thing who it is that's going to be in charge of that, whether it's going to be Linda Zeller you would send this to, or if it's going to be, who is the point person at the state. If you have to go all the way up to Nick Lyon, or if you talk to Linda Zeller or that, to find out who that is. But ultimately, you just keep calling them. So you know what so are there any nurses in here? Yeah, so what do you do when a doctor pisses you off? You hammer page them, right? You're like, you're not calling me back. I'm going to page you every 7 minutes until you call me back. Right? I've had that done to me. I know. It's the reality. Do that. You just put it on your calendar every morning, 8:30 a.m., I'm going to call. I'm going to call you. I'm going to bug the shit out of you. And I'm going to bug you, and I'm going to bug you, and I'm going to bug you. And you just keep doing it. Because that's the way that I got my clinic built. That's the way that we got all this stuff changed over where we are. That's the way that we got guidelines in the state. That's the way that we, you know, get this stuff done. It's not because it's the normal, well, God, I just wish they'd do their job. Now, they have reasons as well. They have a small amount of money to do a large amount of a job. So that pie is not going to necessarily get bigger. So you have to fight for the slice that you need. And that's you're fighting for your patients and every future patient that has that same issue. So once you get the pathway built, the pathway's built, and then it becomes easy. But if you take 4 or 5 physicians and you guys rotate and everybody calls every hour of the day, every day, I'm serious. If they're not doing the satisfactory job for treating a disease that you guys have identified, let them know and continue to let them know until they get it done, because it's not acceptable. It's just not. I mean, and so we have the capability. The MD or DO at the end of your name gives you more power than you know. use that power for good and not for evil.
It's interesting what you say about the methadone being the worst alternative, because within the constraints of Michigan Medicaid, with the new formulary, but I think even most of the old formularies, there were two long-acting narcotics that were approved, and one was methadone and the other was morphine sulfate-sustained release. So when we go to transition a patient who's on chronic short-acting narcotics to a long-acting narcotic, those are the two choices that we have.
No, those are the two choices that you have without extra paperwork. I mean, let's be honest. So you can write for any drug, and you can fight. I am 100%. I have never been denied a drug that I needed for my patient, ever. And the reason being is because you just have to go through the pathway. But once you go through the pathway, we then had my MAs. We had every single one of my prior authorization forms for whoever we needed it for pre-filled out with what they needed from a diagnostic. We made sure that the note said exactly what they needed. Once you build those systems, they can't deny it. They may filter it, but when they say denied, we assume that the first one's always going to be denied. We assume that the second one's always going to be denied. I assume that at noon I'm going to be on the phone with their pharmacist. And so once you just assume that that's the right thing to do and you just do it consistently, and at that point after you've done it for a while, they just start approving it.
Could you just direct me a little bit, because in that argument, what data can I allude to about methadone not being effective long-acting withdrawal strategy? Like, you're saying it has a much higher rate of failure and complications, but
I don't know, the NIH data that showed that it was responsible for 40% of the overdose deaths, but yet only responsible for 7% of the prescriptions, or the data that shows that it is the most highly diverted medication. I mean, this is on the DEA website, the most highly diverted medication on the street, and therefore we shouldn't even be writing it. It's actually moving to tier 2 or tier 3 on the next formulary, so it's not going to be as much of an issue here in the state. So they're moving it off of one of the primary ones. The one that I fought for, that after I left the state, I don't know if it's going to happen. I'm still behind the scenes fighting for it, is for long-acting hydromorphone, because it is one pill. It's pretty protected per day, and it's generic. But I don't know if that's going to happen yet. But when you have the final formulary that comes out, the statewide formulary, I mean, that's going to make it a little harder, but it doesn't make it impossible. And so you use your state medical society that still gets access behind closed doors. You make sure that you find out who's on the governor's committee that's going to continue. I was on the original committee for opioid use, misuse, and abuse, and now they're forming a permanent committee to make sure you find out who's on the committee, and you identify them, and then you talk with them and say, these are the things we need, because honestly, there's been a lot of things that have changed because of that committee, and that has influence and it has access to get those things done, and that is those are the biggest things. But from an individual standpoint, just prepare for paperwork, and that's just the reality of our job, unfortunately, for now. All right, we're over, and I have to walk across the hallway and do another 4 hours of this. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it. If you have any questions, I think I have a few minutes I can answer right outside. Otherwise, have a great day.